The memoirs of Dr. Watson are presented. Ventilation Hole, from the series. Notes on Sherlock Holmes. And that day was no different from hundreds of others. The day started with the usual morning sherry. I'd habitually dozed off after the third glass when something made me wake up, and I saw Holmes beside me, completely dressed. It was only a 7:15, and so I looked at him with surprise and some annoyance. I am very sorry to wake you, Watson, and I understand that it is surprising for you to see me fully dressed. But this morning, we all had to get up early. First, they woke up, Mrs. Hudson. She woke me up. I woke you up. Some young lady came here in great agitation and demands us. God, I'm so worried. She sits and waits with us in the living room. Here she is. And when young ladies drive around the capital at this hour of the morning in such a state and wake up people, it should be assumed that they need something very important. And if this case turns out to be interesting as well, you will probably want to follow it from the beginning. That's why, just in case, I decided to wake you up. Oh, Holmes, I'm always so happy when you wake me up, and this time is no exception. Hello, I am Sherlock Holmes, and this is my close friend Dr. Watson, in whose presence you can speak as freely as in private with me. It's just fact up. No, not so free. Oh, sorry. I would like you to listen to me. Don't worry. We are attentive and ready to listen to you. But you're shivering all over with goosebumps. So I recommend you have a cup of hot sherry. But I'm not shivering from the cold, but from fear, from terrible fear. Oh, don't be afraid. This is my son Vyacheslav. I picked it up while serving on a military campaign. When we burned their village and he was left an orphan, I felt responsible for this young creature. Took him with me, and now I intend to raise him in the spirit of the English lords. We'll figure out what's wrong soon, and we'll sort it out, no doubt. You, I see, arrived this morning on an open carriage. Why, I see the half of the return ticket in your glove. You probably had to drive for a long time on a hard, bumpy road. And besides that, the left sleeve of your blouse is splattered with mud in at least 7 places. This mud is still quite fresh, and I don't know of any other carriage that would splash mud like that when, moreover, it has to sit on the left side of the coachman. But I was on the train, and I walked from the station. Go on. I have come to tell you that I cannot live like this any longer, that I will certainly go mad if this continues. I ask you, help me, at least to illuminate that thick darkness of uncertainty and mystery that surrounds me. At the present moment, I cannot reward you with anything for your services. But in a month or two, I will be married. And then I can't even more. So I will try to be grateful to you before marriage. So you don't have to worry about this. I can only say that I will be very glad to devote myself to you. As for the award, I find it in my calling. But if you would like to bear the costs that I may have to pay for your case, such as additional registration fees, accounting services, and logistics, then you can pay me them at the time and place that is convenient for you. Now I will ask you to tell us everything that can give an idea about your case. Watson, don't you think that this dance, with its unique choreography, is somewhat reminiscent of the case of the dancing men? This is when they first killed Mr. Cubitt, who turned to us for help, and then slightly crippled his wife. Holmes, you are indeed a great detective. Vyacheslav learned this dance just in time for the anniversary of that case, and we all heartily congratulate you on this significant date. Ooh, Mr. Cubitt, how are you? After the holidays, I will visit you at the cemetery. But maybe you'll still let me continue my story. Yes, of course, sorry, but you understand, such a day. Vyacheslav, start the engine. We listened to you, and the girl said her name was Helen Stoner, that her mother died sometime under unclear circumstances. She lives with her stepfather, the last descendant of one of the oldest Saxon families in England, Roylet of Stoke Moran Castle, whose prowess was widespread on the western border of the province of Surrey. The family was once one of the wealthiest in England, and its holdings extended from the borders of Yorkshire and the Humber beyond Surrey to Berkshire in the north and Hampshire in the west, and as far as Chaming in the south to the borders of Murdersk. Dr. Roy Locke served in India as a military doctor, became interested in various esoteric teachings, and returned a changed person. He became angry and rude, argued with all your neighbors, and for a fight with Mr. Gating. He even served 6 months in prison because he knocked out and ate his tooth. And after the death of his wife, his stepfather went completely crazy. He spent his days teaching his baboon various martial arts, making contact with the gypsies and dancing with them in the fields at night. And I want to tell you about the strange death of Mike Winsister. Did you say Winsister? From here on out, pay attention to the details. This will not be difficult for me, because all the smallest circumstances, these terrible minutes are engraved in my memory. Our house consists of several floors and an outbuilding. All bedrooms are located on the ground floor of this wing. The living rooms are in the middle part of the building. Of these bedrooms, the first is Dr. Roylott's room, the second is my sister's room, the last one is mine. There are no communications between them. Separate rooms. Yes. In addition to the baboon, Dr. Roy Locke brought from India many different animals, the most beloved of which were the hyena and the baboon. Well, of course, what other animals did he bring? There are many different. Kangaroos, grey goose, skunk, Surinamese toad, and many others. But they all live right in our house. Here's a photo. So, Vyacheslav, go. Oh, well, it's immediately clear that this is a strong family, certainly. So on that fateful evening, after feeding his animals, Father Roy Locke went early to his bedroom, but did not go to bed. My sister knew this by the strong smell of his strong Indian aroma sticks, the smoke of which entered her room and disturbed her. What smells did he consider preferable? He loved the smell of Nepalese eucalyptus, rarely Chanel and margarita pizza. Ooh, pizza margarita. Yes. Well, you know that the mesmerizing smell of baked cheese, tomatoes, and salama. Do you know, Watson, the smell of salama? Of course I know. I also served in India like your dad, and aroma sticks are not an empty phrase for me. In this sense, I even moved on to meditative activities. Well, tell us about it sometime, and I don't think they served in the same area where Helen's father served, but I know for sure that in each region the sticks are prepared differently. Helen, you don't know where your father served. Oh, it's almost there. I served in the Jinjin Appel district. Lord, I forgot that Vyacheslav is here. It's his mother. But go on, Miss Stoner. As a rule, after inhaling this smoke, about an hour after it started, they came to sit with me and chat about the upcoming wedding. We have been doing this since we were 10 years old, and this fateful day was no exception. At 11 o'clock, she was about to leave, but suddenly asked me, why did she get ready to leave at 11? Was she in a hurry to get somewhere? I don't know. My sister and I always thought that 11 was the right time to leave. So what did she ask you? Tell me, Helen, do you ever hear some special whistle at night? Special, like this one. No. Another special one, like this? No. Ricky, get the fact out of here. The fatty rich is fact. No, I have not heard. So you've never heard such a whistle before? I didn't even understand what kind of whistle she was talking about then. Didn't you ask how long ago she started hearing this whistle? Yes, I asked her about it. How long ago did you start hearing this whistle? I've been hearing it all this week. About what time did it start? From about 8 o'clock. Did it end in the morning? Was it always the same? So long or intermittent? Or maybe a combination? No, heterogeneous. Sometimes it seemed to me that this was actually the farewell of a sloth, and sometimes it seemed like Billie Jean. Has whistling always been melodic? No, not always. What classical melodies were featured? Could it be Beethoven's Ode to Joy? Infrequently,
liar.
Somewhere before 2:30. I don't understand where this whistle can come from. Well, okay. It doesn't really matter. I'll get married soon anyway. I couldn't sleep and sit on the bed. The wind was howling in the yard. The rain was whipping and beating on the window. And I just sat there, admiring the moderate biological weather conditions, pondering the benefits of marriage. And it seemed that I had taken over our world forever, and this raging storm would never stop. Against this background, marriage did not seem so pointless. That is, before this conversation, you were convinced that getting married was not so necessary. Of course, I thought, well, I'll get married. Well, why is this necessary? And besides, it seemed to me that marriage would have a detrimental effect on the free time I have now. I always thought it wasn't right for me. Indeed, in this case, the decision to get married must, of course, be thoroughly considered. Yes, this is exactly what I want to tell you about next. So on that terrible day, I almost decided to go to bed suddenly. Amid the noise of the storm, a wild cry of a frightened woman was heard. And it seemed to me that I heard a soft whistle and the ringing sound of a metal object that my sister told me about. Running out into the corridor, I rushed to my sister's room. Thousands of disturbing thoughts, like a swarm of annoying flies, were buzzing in my head. What could happen? Why did I hear the sound of falling pans? Why are all these animals running? This is not a complete list of what I was thinking about at that moment. And suddenly I heard the door of my sister's room unlock, and so that it was slowly opening. I looked at the door in horror, not knowing what would appear behind it, and shuddered at every movement of a shadow or flash of lightning. Fear overwhelmed me, and it seemed to me that I was going crazy, and my whole body was covered with pimples. You've started to get goosebumps. Yes, I started to get very big goosebumps, and in the light of the lamp in the corridor, I saw my sister standing in the open door. She stretched her arms forward, as if seeking support, and staggered all over, as if drunk. She swayed first to the right, then to the left, then suddenly bent as if from sharp pain, and she screamed. She hit the wall twice. Her legs were cramping, and her arms were twisted like a corkscrew. Stop it already. Well, really. Her body was seized by the last strongest spasm, and she screamed. Ventilation hole. And suddenly she fell. The stepfather had already run out of his bedroom. He ran up to my sister and poured a bottle of vodka down her throat, but it didn't help. And she died without returning to consciousness. Such was the terrible death of my dear sister. Let me ask again if you are quite sure that you heard a whistling and metallic sound. Can you swear on a holy book? Yes, I am ready to assert this at any trial. But was your sister dressed? Yes, she was wearing a moon white nightgown. A pen was found in her right hand. This is extremely interesting. What do you think she could have used the pen for? The forensic investigator concluded that most likely she was working with documents before her death, and decided not to attach importance to this. Although it seemed to me at some point that the figure of a gypsy woman, with whom Mr. Roylock had recently been very closely communicating, flashed near the sister's body. He called her Papusha. In the darkness of the corridor, it was difficult for me to make out, but as time passed, it began to seem to me more and more that I saw her. And do you think the pen appeared in your sister's hand after this woman approached her? Yes, it seems so to me. It even seems to me that I saw a pen in the hand of Papusha, who, it seems to me, also slipped past me. It seems that the data is very, very vague. Watson, do you remember the case of the crooked fingers? I remember something like that, but not very well. Something is pulsating in my head. Pulse better. It was then that I completed experiments refuting the generally accepted misconception that the pupils of a dead person retain the imprint of the last thing the deceased saw. Yes, I remember something. Quite a few eyes were torn out then. I pulled out 17,000 eyes. And not always from the dead. But science is science, and the breadth of experimental data requires some effort. So I don't regret anything. There's nothing to regret. But in the process of studying the eyes, I suddenly discovered a completely unexpected effect. I experimentally proved that the hand of a deceased person after his death, if you sharply insert a pen into it, or just some nameless oblong object, is reflexively capable of putting his signature, or simply rub something. But only once. Do you think this has anything to do with Helen's case? Who knows? Who knows? Afterwards, it turned out that I was not the only one conducting experiments with my hands. Trying to find additional information, I came across an abstract by a modest professor of morphology at the Faculty of Medical Biology from the city of BRNO, hiding under the letter M. God, letter M. Yes, yes, Watson. You understood everything correctly. Under the letter M was the king of the underworld, Professor Moriarty, who tirelessly also carried out experiments in this area. In fact, this is how he amassed his initial capital, since all the dead people from BRNO signed over their property to him. Dodger, what can you say about the poison? I don't know anything about poisons, but the doctors examined the body and found no signs of poison. Was an autopsy performed, as well as biological laboratory tests. The police didn't think about it. We decided to just examine the body, and that's it. But they examined it quite thoroughly with the entire police station. Even the police came from the neighboring town to also examine it. And what conclusion did they come to? What did this poor girl die from? Absolutely no ideas on this matter. How do you explain to yourself these words of hers about the hole, about the ventilation hole? Sometimes it seems to me that it was just nonsense. She generally had this habit of shouting out some single words. This has been with her since childhood. She probably saw something that others didn't see and tried to communicate. Holmes shook his head as if dissatisfied with this explanation. This is a very dark matter, he said. Please continue your story. 2 years have passed since then. My life became even more lonely than before. But suddenly Percy Armitage, the second son of Rudy Armitage from Cronwater, near Reading, invited me to build a relationship with him. My stepfather agreed to this marriage in advance, and our wedding will soon take place. But 2 days ago, a wall was broken in my bedroom, and I had to temporarily move into my sister's bedroom. And lying in bed, I heard a whistle. What type of whistle did you hear? Sounds like a meteorist whistling. You did the right thing by coming to me. Have you told me everything? Yes, all. What do you say if Watson and I immediately go to your house? I agree. Great. Do you agree to this trip, Watson? Agree. So, that means we'll both come. What do you intend to do yourself? I have some other needs to attend to in the city, but I will return home by the 12:04 train so that I can be there when you arrive. So that's great. Would you like some hot cherry for breakfast? No, I don't have time. What do you think about this case, Watson? To be honest, I didn't find this girl's story interesting. These mysterious events around weddings, some kind of night whistling. For some reason, they broke through her wall. Some kind of nonsense, and also a hyena and a baboon. If she had said at the end that the hyena was her stepfather, or he was just a pure devil, then I, as a doctor, would have been obliged to call a medical team from a psychiatric clinic, since such delusional ideas cannot be explained by anything other than schizophrenia. Watson, don't rush to conclusions. Well, Holmes, what do you think? I, as a doctor, am probably able to understand whether the patient is delusional or not. And also Papusha. And yes, Papusha. What is this Papusha? Which Papusha? There are no such names. Watson, don't be in such a hurry. This mysterious pen in the hand of Sister Helen suggests certain thoughts. Yes, every day I fall asleep with a pen in my hand and nothing. As you can see, I systematically wake up back with a pen. Yes, but I would still advise you to wake up better with Mrs. Watson. Moreover, she also knows how to write. But you can put Mrs. Watson in your hand instead of a pen. Vyacheslav, close your ears. But I'm definitely sure that you can insert a pen into her. Sorry, Watson. Couldn't resist. But I meant to the hand, of course. I understand.
What?
Watch that noise in the hallway. No, you won't come in. No, I'll come in. No, you won't come in. I said I'll come in. No, I'm not asking you. No, you won't come in. Put away your claws. Get away, old animal. Sir, would you please be quiet and explain to us the reason for your coming? Who's Holmes here? Miss Hudson, please release our unnamed guest and give us something to do with him. Okay, I'll go warm you up some drinks then. So, my dear sir, I am forced to repeat my question. Who is Holmes here? I ask you. Holmes, it's me. What should I call you? I'm Grizzly Royal from Scott Morin, and I want to know why my fucking stepdaughter came to you. What the fuck? What did she tell you? To my delight, my friend reacted absolutely serenely to Roylock's cries. He even seemed to be Mikinga. Did that old fool Farintosh quite it at you? What? What? Answer. What she told me concerns only me. Oh, don't think you're special. Only me. You'll tell me everything, you suckers. I'm not some Wintum Brook Eagle fool. I didn't break off people like you either. It's clear to you, fuck you motherfuckers. Holmes seemed not even touched by this abuse. He looked like, as if nothing irritated him. Sir, I ask you not to express yourself and to leave my house. Yeah, you want to get rid of me. I know you, scoundrel. I've heard about you before. You like to poke your nose into other people's affairs. My friend smiled. You sneak. Holmes smiled even wider. Police bloodhound. Holmes laughed heartily. You are a surprisingly pleasant interlocutor. When leaving here, close the door. Otherwise, it's really drafty. Don't you dare interfere in my fucking affairs. I know that fucking Miss Stoner was here, and I was keeping an eye on her. Woe to anyone who gets in my way. Be careful. Don't fall into my clutches. Otherwise, I'll shove wooden dicks up your ass. Are you smiling? Yes, this is what I will do to you. No, you will live in now. I won't leave until I find out. No, you will leave. No, I won't leave. No, please leave. No, I won't leave. Okay, I'm leaving, but you're fucked if you dare meddle in my affairs. Well, Watson, what do you say now? I think, Holmes, that this family is an example of an unimaginable symbiosis of crazy and criminal elements that pose a threat to society, like daughters and their dad. But they are not his daughters. This makes it even more dangerous, and only now I am beginning to understand how good it is that you are going on this dangerous mission with Vyacheslav and me. Well, Watson, let's refresh ourselves with hot sherry before the road and go to Bryn Tington Station. Well, at least this time without Papusha. We shouldn't be in such a hurry. Vyacheslav took care of the tickets. I think he got the best seats in the sleeper car. Yes, he took care and took a ticket for the restaurant car, and it is at the very beginning of the train, so we need to have time to reach it before the train starts moving. Vyacheslav just read in the advertising booklet that this train has excellent karaoke. Oh, let's hurry then. I think I can already see our carriage. I managed to get hold of the will of Roylock's deceased wife, and I also made a calculation of their own funds, securities that represent their entire capital. Roylock lost out on junk investments, and his annual income dropped significantly. If at least one daughter got married, he would have to give away a huge part of the remaining capital to his daughter. That's the question. This county has some very strange laws, Watson. According to local rules, if a girl agrees to get married and signs a declaration of intent and then dies, Then her inheritance in any case goes to her future husband. How's that? Yes, but he was counting on these funds, making plans, and it would be immoral to deprive the groom of the most important reason why he decided to get married in the first place. This is partly true. But then it turns out that it was just unprofitable for the Roylock to kill his stepdaughter. Are you sure? In which case would you be interested in finishing off? Well, for example, Vyacheslav, if he could bring you problems such as losing part of your capital due to his marriage. I got it. If he was getting married and decided to sign the letter of intent, then I would have to kill him before he could do it. That's right, Watson. What if Vyacheslav still managed to get married alive? So it turns out I would lose part of my capital, and you would kill him simply out of dissatisfaction for the damage caused. That is, Vyacheslav would not have remained alive in any of these cases. So we have to figure out what type of crimes are in Stoke Moran. So, what do you have here? Well, I went along the medical line. You know that I have a lot of experience in this field, and I managed to get the dental records of the Roylott family. And what's there? Actually, nothing special. Roylock has no problems with teeth. Well, at least this is something, Watson. At least we know about it now. And as you know, in our business, any detail can play a decisive role. What does Vyacheslav have? Yes, Vyacheslav took out an extract from the house register of the Stoke Moran estate, and it turned out that the Roylock's house had recently been mortgaged. The mortgagee is a certain Jessica Friedrich. Jessica Friedrich. Is that exactly what it says? Yes, you can see for yourself. Not a bad song. Symptomatic. It looks like this case is growing like a snowball. No, this cannot be true. What's happened? Have you ever seen this guy, Watson? No, I've never seen him. What can you tell about him from the photo? Well, I think that this is a rather wealthy gentleman. I draw this conclusion from his plump belly and gold watch chain. And he is probably not without education, although in the past he may have been a military man or a sailor. Most likely he served as a midshipman on some military battleship. It's a beaver. Beaver. I would never have thought such a thing. But he looks so respectable that he could serve on a battleship, perhaps, but that's not the main thing. This is not just some ordinary beaver, of which you can find at least a pack on every battleship. This is Professor Moriarty's personal beaver. His passport name is Friedrich, but the professor calls him Jessica. Jessica. Beautiful name. This beaver is very lively. 3 years ago, this same Jessica defeated heavyweight Bruno Jordans at the ESPEF tournament in Calgary. Could he really be involved in this matter? We can't speak with certainty yet, but I'll tell you, as a practitioner, any business can end with a beaver. Sure shall a beaver. This is very true, Watson. So it seems to me that in the light of new facts, the pen in Sister Helen's hand after her death is no longer an insignificant detail, because it was the beaver's owner, Moriarty, who knew about the theory of crooked fingers. In general, we will need to send this request to the local registry office and ask whether Sister Helen's marriage agreement was signed. Vyacheslav shouldn't have hot sherry for breakfast in the morning. Well, we'll send you later from the station, and one thing is already clear. Roylock is not interested in marrying off his stepdaughters. And what are they to him even more than stepdaughters? Oh my God, Holmes. Watson, the world is inharmonious, and there is always room for fantasies, and even shameful ones, but that's not the point now. I'm afraid that everything is turning against Helen, and literally everyone wants to kill her, but Roylock can do any nasty thing. He'll take it and buy, for example, with all the remaining money, some junk bonds or structured products. Huh. What then? I can't believe he could do such a terrible thing. Oh, Vyacheslav, look, this is your favorite song. Come on, show them all. Nobody sings this song better than Vyacheslav. Is this Stoke Moran? Yes, sir. This is the house of Dr. Grizzly Roylet. They are rebuilding there. Quite possible, sir. Yes, they want to cover the roof with something clear. And that's exactly what we're here for. Engineers, we will make certain measurements. I don't interfere in other people's affairs. Goodbye, sir. I specifically, just in case, told this man that we came here to rebuild. Let him think that we are architects, or something like that. This will prevent any gossip from arising. And this is my son Vyacheslav. I picked him up for an Indian company. Here comes Mrs. Stoner. Hello, gentlemen. I've been waiting for you so impatiently. I'm just leaving the store. Let me give you a ride, especially since it's not far. Right here. Hop on my camel. Everything worked out perfectly. Dr. Roylaw had gone into town and probably wouldn't return until the evening. Yes, we had the pleasure of meeting your dad. How? He came to our home. My God, I can't explain how this could happen. Was he following me? Yes, it looks like that. But don't worry. He didn't bother us too much. Honestly, Mrs. Hudson beat him up. Ward Mr. Holmes, I'm so ashamed that I dragged you into this story. Ward, I'm so ashamed. There's nothing to be ashamed of, Miss Stoner. After all, life is inharmonious, and there is enough room in it for various phenomena. And even shameful ones. I try not to think about shameful phenomena. My difficult childhood within the walls of this gloomy house is enough for me. I can imagine how subtly time dragged on for you and your sister. Yes, only once did we feel some kind of inner uplift when the gardener Orlando worked for us for a short time. But that was so long ago that it no longer seems true. How's Orlando? What kind of Orlando? This morning you said that you told us everything about this matter, but as I understand it, this is not so. You didn't say a word about Orlando. But I didn't think that old story had anything to do with this case. Miss Stoner, let us, simple private detectives, decide for ourselves what has to do with what. I ask you to be more attentive to details next time. Fine. Orlando, well, Watson, what is your favorite female name? For some time now, I have Papusha, and I have Sarah. Yes, what is Mrs. Watson's name? Sarah, well, I see. Miss Stoner, what are these interesting structures sticking out here and there at home? I already told you that Roylock brought in many different animals. So, for better communication, Roylock made a lot of underground passages through which they moved. So. Interesting. Well, love for animals clearly does not belong to human vices. Vyacheslav let go of the horse. Well, what do we have here? A house made of gray, lichen-covered stone. Yes, and we have two more semicircular wings, as if outstretched, like a crab's claw, on both sides of the high central part. But in one of these wings, the windows are boarded up, and the roof had caved in places. The central part really seems to be quite destroyed, but the right wing has been relatively recently repaired. Yes, and from the curtains on the windows, it's clear that people live here. What is it made of? Sand, lime, brick, foundation, concrete, window, plastic, good sealed, soundproof windows. Holmes began to walk slowly across the uncleared lawn, looking carefully at the window. This must be the window of the room where you slept before, in the middle of your sister's window. And this is probably the window of Dr. Roylott's room. Yes, that's absolutely right. But now I sleep in my sister's roomies. Where's your sister? Unfortunately, she died. Sorry, I didn't know. Helen, how can you explain that some of these animals look unusual? This is the result of training with Dr. Roylock. This is a word about shameful phenomena. He has his own system of spiritual development, which he brought from the Indian campaign. After a couple of weeks of such training, any animal, even a giraffe, became strong and lean, and everyone looked like this. Oh my God. Well, are you going to play the fool for a long time? Something tells me that training alone will not achieve such an amazing result. But the investigation will show. Come on, show us your room. Holmes decided not to examine the third room, and we went straight into the second, where Miss Stoner now slept and where her sister had died. It was a room with a low ceiling and a wide fireplace. In one corner there was a chest of drawers. The other corner was occupied by a narrow bed, and to the left of the window was a dressing table. Watson, could you please stop commenting? Holmes, well, you know that this is what I do for a living. Holmes took a chair and sat silently in the corner. His eyes carefully slid up and down the walls, ran around the room, studying and examining every little thing. Wait a minute, I don't want to sit on a chair. What is this pipe? This is a unique development of local scientists, a ventilation hole, and at the same time a housekeeper's call. Look here. Interesting. But this system seems to be newer than the rest of the things in the room. Yes, this call was recently arranged here, 2 or 3 years ago. Perhaps your sister asked for this. No, I've never heard of her using it. We are used to doing everything ourselves. Moreover, we don't have a housekeeper. A very unusual system. There is a bell, but there is no housekeeper. I saw this when I worked for an Indian company. There are also split systems. This is when you hit a pipe here, and the sound is somewhere there. And so you can hear it louder. Resonates. Spherical wave propagation. That is, it can be heard far away, and then you don't need to call the housekeeper. You can call yourself. Watson, but you are not calling the housekeeper for her to call, but in order for her to come. Holmes, whatever you say. I trust you, but this is all very suspicious. Quite possible. But if you'll excuse me for a moment, I need to check the floor. But in general, I like the room. It's clean, quite tidy. Well, now everything is clear. Let's move to the next room. Well, Dr. Roylock's room does not make any repulsive impression. Yes, an ordinary room. He lives, as I see it, quite aesthetically. Yes, this room doesn't really stand out. Wardrobe, bed, table, share well. No frills. Miss Stoner, tell me, are there many cats in the house? There are no cats at all. How can you explain this amount of cat food? I can say for sure, but maybe this is what Dad feeds his animals. I knew it. Iron pussy food. Yeah, I didn't expect this. It's a really funny name. Iron pussy. Wow, they came up with something. Watson, everything here is much more serious than a funny name. What do you have in mind? This is a very long story to tell. Naturally, this is connected with the ancient manuscripts that I studied in Nepal. But we have time. Okay, then listen. In ancient times, the world was ruled by 12 gods, according to the number of months in the year, and their names were also January, February, March, April, Ku, Kol, June, July, August, September, October, Blow, George, and December. Wow, nothing has changed since then. I call the months the same way. Watson, well, everything can be expected from you, but if you haven't noticed, then several months there are called somewhat unusually. But this is in accordance with the traditions of that area. Cuckold, because during this month, different types of deer grow very beautiful antlers. This means everything is fine with calcium. And the Blow George, because this month is always very windy. It's as if someone is working straight, blowing the wind. He should have been better called Blowmaster. Watson, if you like it that way, call November Blowmaster. Fine. The gods in those days lived in a mode of manual control of people. Well, you remember these stories and legends about ancient relationships. And no matter what you take hold of, literally from every teapot, some Zeus will come out. Then someone will take possession of someone, or something even worse. Because apart from some atrocities, the gods usually did not come up with anything. And when they showed up on Earth, in their inimitable style, they did whatever they wanted with people. Especially, naturally, from the sexual sphere. And from medical. From medical, too. Okay. But I'll say right away that not everyone liked it, and especially for ancient women. Men, they went back and forth, but they were more or less normal about it. But the women rebelled, and the instigator herself was the daughter of a blacksmith named Michelle. Well, the gods naturally arrived. Everyone was suppressed. Well, it is clear that during the suppression, as usual, they did everything possible and impossible to think of with the rebels. But it doesn't matter, they suppressed them. And as punishment, they cast a spell on the instigator, Michelle, that she would be a nymphomaniac. But that if any person looked into her eyes, she would turn into stone. Naturally, she had to go to the mountains and live as a hermit, where she lived for many years. The gods amused themselves by letting lonely passers-by astray so that they would wander into Michelle's territory, where they would meet her and turn into stone. After some years, Kukold proposed making sure that people turn not into stone, but into cottage cheese. He believed that it would be funnier this way when they would not turn to stone, but crumble into a large curd granule. Naturally, it turned out to be funnier, and Michelle's life continued. Now she turned everyone into cottage cheese, and at the same time, she did not even have the opportunity to look at herself in the mirror and put herself in order, because she thought that if she looked, she would turn herself into the same thing. This was not true, but she was a limited woman and fought so. Nymphomaniac properties tormented her, and at night her moans could be heard in the surrounding area. Because she was burning, you know, from what desire. So tell the truth, even in the area where were no stones with pointed ends left, everything was rounded, how she suffered. And the gods looked at her and made fun of her. Well, after a few more years, it became boring to look at again. And Kukold suggested making it so that anyone who ate the cottage cheese lying around would turn into a human. He tried to imagine in his mind what type of person everyone would turn into. But the only image that popped into his head was his maternal second cousin named Gustav. Well, let everyone be like Gustav, he decided. A blind cat named Myawachi was nearby, came across a pile of cottage cheese, and began to eat. After 8 days, he turned into a man identical to Kukol's brother, Gustav. In great surprise, he wandered around the area until he accidentally met Michelle. When she realized that he was blind and there was no danger of him turning into cottage cheese, she was incredibly happy and began to tame him. And soon they decided to build a relationship. happiness came into Michelle's life for the first time in so many years. What am I talking about? This extract of the first cottage cheese served as the source of the starter culture for the production of Iron Pussy. And then the secret of this extract was passed on from mouth to mouth. And they even created entire armies of Gustavs. But soon King Richard banned this food, and everyone who knew how to make it was burned. And people lost the recipe for this wonderful food that smart people fought. But as we see, this is not entirely true. And now it is clear what is happening to the animals in this house. What happened next for Michelle? They lived in perfect harmony. Now at night, her moans of dissatisfaction were no longer heard, but only of satisfaction. Yes, and during the day too. Michelle did not let Mayawachi go for a minute, and among other things, they spent time in pleasant conversations. Mayawachi knew everything about the life of cats and was ready to endlessly share this with Michelle. And she especially liked it when he showed how kittens suck milk, like this. But the happiness could not last long, only 5 years. At some point, the cuckold got bored again and started planning evil things. He came to Michelle and told her that he was removing the spell from her, that she deserved it, but it will return if she herself, in a fit of anger, wishes for it. She thought some more. Yes, I won't wish for this, and that's all what are the problems. Then Cuckold went to the sleeping Mayawachi and made him see clearly, and Cuckold himself hit the ground and appeared before her in the form of a beautiful girl. He asked, "Who are you, oh beautiful girl?" "I'm Michelle. Don't you recognize me?" said the Cuckold, imitating Michelle's voice. Mayawachi would recognize this voice from thousands of others. He screamed and rushed to her. "Oh God, how beautiful you are." And they merged in a passionate kiss. And the real Michelle was just about to put on her makeup without looking in the mirror when she suddenly heard voices and smacking sounds outside. Coming out into the air, she saw Mayawachi making love with some young maiden. She screamed loudly. Her throat was constricted with anger, and her scream was like the call of a crow. "What are you doing? What's happening?" He looked at her, saw a dirty, unkempt woman, not looking fresh, and asked, "What does she want?" "It's me, Michelle." "No, you're not Michelle. Here's my Michelle. And you go away. Are you chasing me?" And then she saw what he was seeing. "Lord, you can see," she cried. "Yes, I can see. And I don't like what I see. Here's Michelle. I don't know who you are. Leave or I will stone you." And the cuckold smiled disgustingly, looking at all this. Mayawachi took a mirror out of his pocket, looked at himself, and said, "Yes, I'm too attractive, and you don't deserve me, no matter who you are. Maybe even she is also unworthy of me." Michelle screamed in anger. "How much have I spent on you of my spiritual energy and love, and here is your gratitude. How I wish I could again have the ability to turn people into stone, that is, into cottage cheese. I would turn you and your slat." "Why the slat right away?" And yes, she said it. This was Cuckold's cunning plan, and he wanted to enjoy the tragedy. How she would turn him now. And then sob over a pile of cottage cheese, cursing herself for incontinence. Well, that's all. But suddenly, the month of December appeared. It turns out that he also followed the story of Michelle and her cottage cheese. And he also decided to participate. And his authority was greater than that of Cuckold. And December said,
"I offer you a test! If in 14 days you are able to regain love of Mayalachi, then you will become free! And I will also fulfill any of your wishes! If not, then you will forever remain like this! Cast! And you will turn people not even into cottage cheese, but into a stinking lemonade!"
And disappeared. The 13-day countdown has begun. Mayawachi continued to avoid Michelle, but it was noticeable that he also stopped paying attention to the young woman. That he looks at himself more and more in a hand mirror. And at night he mutters something like, "This old woman won't get me. She doesn't deserve me. And this young woman won't get me either. And in general, there is no one who would be worthy of me. I am the most beautiful. I will run away from here and go to the barber shop. Because only someone like me or myself deserves me." Michelle was rushing around wondering what she should do. It would even be to hell with this weakling. She just didn't want to turn everyone into cottage cheese again, but she couldn't find the answer. Time passed, and then on the third night of the 13-day period, the month below George came to her in a dream. He also followed this story, and in between his affairs, such as sulfur from the sky or massive various bloodletting events, he decided to make his contribution. He said that the answer is very simple. If Michelle goes and finds a bunch of cottage cheese and eats it, then in 8 days she will become the same as Maya Achi. That is, she will become Gustav. But you will cease to be a woman, he added. And who will I become, she asked. Gustav, answered Blow George, and disappeared into the air. Michelle didn't think twice. What the hell is it like to be a disheveled grandmother who turns everyone into cottage cheese, when you can become something new? Well, at least Gustav. And she went to the nearest pile of cottage cheese. On the 8th day, Maya Achi saw himself next to him. Michelle has been reborn. He didn't immediately understand who it was. Are you me? He asked. No, I'm Gustav, Michelle answered. And now we will be together forever. And at that same moment, an arrow of love pierced Maya Achi's heart. I realized what I needed. He said, but who are you? I did not hear. I'm Gustav, Michelle answered. And who am I? Maya Achi asked. You too, Gustav, Michelle answered. The cuckold was so surprised that he forgot that he needed to disguise himself and turned into himself. Michelle saw this and said with a disgusted grin, so it was you, the bad person. I knew it. How disgusting you are. One word, cuckold. He was completely taken aback by such impudence. I didn't understand something. What's going on here? Why are you swearing? Am I still a god here or what? Do you know what I can do to you? And at that moment, December appeared. You turned out to be a cunning grandma, he said. And now you are free from spells, and I am ready to fulfill one of your wishes. Michelle fought for a moment. Gold, money, power. To ask for what? She thought frantically, and then it dawned on her. Turn this nit into cottage cheese, she said, pointing her finger at Cuckold.
Have it your way, said December.
What? What are you doing? Hey, wait a second. I don't understand. And at the same moment, Cuckold crumbled into a pile of cottage cheese. The only thing he managed to shout was, damn you all, you fucking people. Dirty swearing. May the cottage cheese into which I will turn always be a curse upon you. And he fell apart. December has disappeared into thin air. Michelle and Maya Achi left to look for their new life. And only the wind played with Cuckold's cottage cheese, carrying them far from these places. And that's why people have been suffering from thrush ever since.
Do not forsake me, oh my darling.
Do you know this song, Watson? God, what a dark story you told, Holmes. It's good that this terrible food was destroyed. Not all, Watson. Lord, this is it. Horrible. Can I borrow a couple of pounds for my poodle? Watson, I'm afraid not. Iron pussy food is prohibited on our island, so we will have to hand it over to the police. Well, what a pity. Why do you need to raise a Gustav from your poodle? Look how many of them are running around here. Then you just take the adult from here right away. So, Miss Stoner, you say that there are no cats in the house, but if everything is clear with the cat food, then this saucer of milk again raises questions. What is it for, do you think? I cannot explain it. How's that? But I think that most likely this is for his papusha. Does she like milk? Well, yes. Lapping up milk at night is considered beneficial. Lapping? Interesting, and in general, their relationship doesn't seem strange to you. Well, you haven't seen her live yet, but I try not to think about it. Well, it's clearing up a little. Now, so Miss Stoner, we will have to spend the night in your room. For this, when it gets dark, we will lie down behind that tree in the yard. When your dad returns home, you will be locked in your room. As soon as you hear that he has gone to his room, you will open the shutters and let us in. But you will need to give us some kind of signal. Maybe you can scream like some bird or animal. I can signal with this ratchet. Great. But now it's only 2:00 in the afternoon. We're not going to go lie under a tree right now, are we? Of course not. Let's wait until dark in that hotel on the mountain. Look, he heard everything. Vyacheslav, he should not leave. I took him off. Until dark, we spent time in the hotel playing Raspakanka, an ancient Scus game that had gained wide popularity in certain circles of London intellectuals. Holmes and I often held tournaments playing it with each other on Boyker Street. As it got dark, we dropped into the post office where Holmes received some correspondence he was expecting and also sent a letter to Scotland Yard asking them to send their best Inspector Lystrick with his group. Well, Watson, my worst fears have been confirmed. Yes, interesting. Holmes, I saw a bench in front of the post office. Let's drag her to Roylock's house, so I still wouldn't want to lie behind a tree. The ground is already frozen. I think about this all the time, too. Holmes and I took the bench in, promising to return it.
Wahaha!
Moved to Roylock's house. At the appointed hour, we took up a position behind a tree. It got dark. Time passed very slowly. Vyacheslav, Vyacheslav, do not sleep. Holmes, I still play Raspakanka better than you. Hardly. No, definitely. Don't think. Of course, there are some coincidences, but over a long statistical period, you are definitely inferior to me. Well, for a long time. Statistically, probably. But have you come up with something? Well, the deductive method. What about Helen's case? I already know everything about Helen's case, and I can say that Roylock will try to kill Helen tonight. He knows we had her. He is furious. He doesn't want her to get married. And he has no time to waste. Tonight will definitely be decisive, which means we need to remain vigilant. And we won't lose. My friend always aroused my admiration because in any situation, everything was always extremely clear to him. And at the same time, he did not stop conducting the investigation. He explained this by the singularity. Something is unusually funny in the gypsy camp on the mountain today. How do you know what kind of atmosphere they usually have? Well, just if they always have so much fun, then all the residents of this town would probably want to move to their camp. Look at this shabby little town. How much strength does it take to see him every day? So Holmes, how do you know? Maybe they all moved. We haven't seen anyone except these. That's right, Watson. After all, Roylock was also drawn there. Apparently, he is the last one left. Definitely Holmes. Let's remember this. For what? Well, we need to pay attention to certain details. Fine. Have you noticed Ward is between the rooms? Yes, I saw this too and was surprised. But the fact is that even before Miss Stolener arrived, I knew that this was between the rooms. And what is it? Ventilation hole. Pipe. This thickness is even more. Yeah. Supernaturally wide. Let's remember this. Well, what conclusions do you come to? I think the pipe is somehow connected with these mysterious events. Exactly. It is obvious that Dr. Roylock uses the pipe in some way in his criminal activities. Holmes, do you know what bothered me the whole time we were looking around the rooms? The diameter of the pipe allows Roylock to crawl into it, and I'm even afraid to imagine that. Watson, against the backdrop of what we already know, that there is room for fantasy in the world, your idea is not so incredible. But on the other hand, the sisters are also not particularly attractive, so to whom it's too much to fantasize here? No, Holmes, you are thinking something of your own. I mean, to climb and drop something on them. Throw it off. Something dangerous. No, no. There's something else here. What? Money, Watson, money. Where there are no fantasies, there is always money, and where it is, there are possible options, but it may be more expensive. I think that Roylock is pushing something through the pipe that kills. But that's exactly what I'm telling you. Yes, yes, Gustav. He throws Gustav into the pipe. He falls on top and strangles his victim. But Sister Helen was not strangled. She died completely differently. So he's injecting himself with a psychotropic injection. Perhaps this option may be quite real. Well, and by the way, no one plants strawberries like this anymore. This also leads to some suspicions. Quite. It looks like the clouds scattering over Miss Stoner are getting too dark. Foggy Albion. God, he heard everything. Vyacheslav, he should not leave. I had to get off. This is Miss Stoner, Watson. It's time. We hid in Sister Helen's room and waited. Holmes had a cane at the ready. I had a poker at the ready. And Vyacheslav was simply ready. Roylock did not go to bed for a long time. He was walking around, creaking, making noise, bristling with something, and crying with someone. And suddenly there was silence. Busted! Holmes, we won. Watson, I don't think this is the end yet. But the three of us can handle it. I could have done it alone. Because, let it be known to you, Watson, that I master the techniques of deadly wrestling, as well as deadly judo. Have you been to Japan? Yes, Watson. So how's it going there? Very technologically advanced. Japan, it's like somewhere on a completely different planet. Yes. And in general, I know all types of martial arts. Holmes, how can this be? Well, see for yourself. What? Seems to have been a zebra before. Smells similar. Do you know what zebra smells like? Here's another one. Come on, Mr. Holmes. Kick his ass. Here, you can't go below the waist. This is Greco-Roman wrestling. Watson, I learned this for 3 years from a Greco-Roman. He was Greek above and Roman below. Ha ha, Roman below. Sambo. The hip throw is the best technique in Sambo. Sambo. My wife, Mrs. Watson, goes to Sambo. Well, that means she's into wrestling, Watson. Some kind of women's section. She says that she always works in tandem with San Miguel. So this is a mixed fight, Watson. Wait a second. Non-contact combat. How can this be? Like this. But I don't like this style. Why? No contact. That's why I like judo more. Look, may I invite you, please? And in vain. This is a common Japanese trick. And now Aikido. What are you doing? What are you doing? Hit a drunk guy. You're just a black belt, Holmes. He's just drunk. Can't stand on his feet at all. They all seem to be drunk here. Breathe. That's right. Busted. Damn drunks. This is a Kushi Kai Kanape. I'm actually aware of Holmes. Well then, Harareira. This is the best technique against drunks. No, this is the best technique, just like in Indian cinema. Well, the mother of all martial arts is the deadly fight of Buritsa. I didn't understand. This is all. It seems the Gustavs are over. Looks like it. And where, by the way, Vyacheslav takes them away all the time. He's just accustomed to order and doesn't like things lying on the floor. V- Vyacheslav has rubber bullets. Vyacheslav, stop it. It seems the Gustavs are really over what the fact. Well, faggots. I warn you pigs not to mess with me. Holmes, he has a snake. This is a swamp viper, the most dangerous snake in India. Beat it. Holmes, look, this is not a Roy Locke, it's a baboon. Watson, no, this is exactly Roy Locke, but he is dead. The poison of the swamp viper kills 9 seconds after the bite, but the viper did not bite me. You just beat me too much. He doesn't understand that the poison is already working. Apparently the hallucination, but it's strange that he's still alive. Could there really be something wrong with the snake and its venom not working? The poison is working, Watson. It just happens more slowly. Have you probably heard of the term whipping effect? It is known that if a person bitten by a snake is beaten thoroughly with sticks, the poison of the snake weakens. So we unwittingly help Roy Locke live a little longer. Thank you, gentlemen. Holmes, where do you always get this information from? Watson, it is known that the brain of any person is an attic. While you are little, your attic is empty. But as you gain experience, your attic becomes cluttered as you learn more and more. And it all goes into your attic, where it has to be sorted out somehow. But there can't be enough space for everything. As a result, everything gets compacted, mixed up, and it becomes more and more difficult for you to find something there. And you no longer understand where everything is. And you turn into a person who cannot distinguish physics from physical education. Do you understand? Lord, how do you deal with this? I just don't have an attic, Watson. And I don't know anything at all. But using the deductive method, I can always find the key to any problem simply by generating a statement in the moment. So you just generated an explanation about the whipping effect. Yes, and as you can see, it is true. Roy Locke is alive, despite being bitten by a swamp viper. Holmes, as usual, you are right. But still, I am somewhat offended by how critical you are of my attic in advance. Watson, don't sulk. Let's check. Just look into your attic and tell us what the first important thing you find there. Fine. Well, I forgot. Well, you see. And so, dear sir, before we hand you over to the police, maybe explain to us the motives for your crime. And not talking to any police snoopers. So much the worse for you. Since we have little time, we will have to torture you. Vyacheslav has a knife. Okay, I'll tell you. When I returned from the Indian company, I began to squander my dead wife's money. By the way, we'll also check where she died from. Check it out. And so, when the money began to run out, I invested everything that was left into investment products in the hope that I would be lucky. But I lost and remained in debt. To them? To whom? Them. To the criminal community that is involved in this case. They put a loan on me, and I even had to get a job. I think I'm starting to guess. And then one fine day, I was guarding a guard post near a cigar factory. I stood crushed and devastated, and suddenly she appeared on the square. Papusha, and it was as if everything around was illuminated by the blessed light of her soul. Temp- temperamental, brave, it was clear that she was used to ruling over everyone. And her habanera could drive anyone crazy. And she turned my head. Oh, she was so hot, so groovy. I couldn't spend a minute without her. Just like that, she quickly burst into my life. But love is expensive, especially a woman like Papusha, and I had no money. And then she said that she would help me. At night, she arranged for me to meet with her stepfather, the leader of the smugglers, in their secret tavern in the mountains. Well, besides the fact that they danced well there, what did they tell you? They were aware that I had brought many different animals from India, and they gave me some special food for them. They told me to start feeding them today, and that in 13 days they would come. So this is where you got your iron pussy food from. Yes, they gave it to me. I didn't mean to. I just loved my animals, and especially the hyena and baboon. Yes, but they needed to turn them into first-class figs and start smuggling cotton. Cotton, is it profitable? Not really, actually. But at least no one is imprisoned for this. Well, if so, then of course it's good. Here you go. And I had no choice. And even more so, when I saw the effect of this food, I even liked it. And since then, at night we have been engaged in smuggling deliveries. How did she force you to kill your stepdaughters? She didn't force it. It's me. She just mentioned it to me absolutely by accident, so to speak.
Kevin,
there it is. Sister Helen is getting married. And then you see, Helen herself will want it. I'm just so happy for them, for our girls. How lucky they are. And when they also receive their inheritance, leaving you beggars, then their affairs will go completely uphill. The main thing is that they are happy, right, dear? When I found out that they were going to get married, I became very angry because of the inheritance. All property is already mortgaged, and you decided to commit these crimes. Yes, but she had nothing to do with it. She even tried to dissuade me, so you included it in your plans. I didn't hide anything from her because she always wanted the best for me. I think you are mistaken, Monsieur Roylock. At least she got you involved in smuggling. And I think, taking advantage of your emotional state, she got involved in some shady dealings with your property. What do you have in mind? Have you ever seen any of these people? No, I haven't seen any of them. And so, that's her. She, my Papusha. But how? I don't understand. How? That's what I assumed. Friedrich, Professor Moriarty's personal beaver, one of the most dangerous criminals in England. No, no. What beaver? Her name is Papusha. My Papusha. God, she's even more beautiful without a wig. It seems the poison is starting to take effect. No number. Unfortunately, this is not Papusha, and your Papusha is most likely no longer alive. What are you saying, Watson? Beaver was Papusha. His real name is Friedrich. Remember, Friedrich. I lived with a beaver Friedrich, with Frederick. But at least I didn't let these two Hauer stepdaughters take my fortune. I'm afraid you're mistaken. I received a response to my request from the registry office, and I can confidently say that they have in their register a declaration of intent signed by Sister Helen. How could this happen? Tell Roy Locke, did you see how this papoosha? Well, that is, the beaver Friedrich signed something from his sister Helen on that terrible night. Do not deny Helen saw this. I also saw that she was spinning around the body of Sister Helen. I won't hide it. Oops, my shoelace came undone. Yes? Well, I can assure you that she was hanging around for a reason and signed a statement of intent using the twisted fingers effect. Are you saying that she deceived me? I cannot believe. But why does she need this? After all the money could have become ours if she agreed to become my wife. It is unlikely that Professor Moriarty's personal beaver named Friedrich would become your wife. All this terrible word Friedrich, doesn't the word beaver scare you? The word beaver is not. Well, mister, I can tell you that with your own hands you have made yourself half a beggar, killing Sister Helen. But at least with Helen herself, he seems to have managed. Hello, Holmes. What's the news? Victims again. Where you are, there are always victims. Have you ever wondered why this is so? Maybe you should leave the house less. Watson. And of course you are here. Hello, Lystrick. I haven't seen you for 100 years. Oh, I see this lunatic is with you too. This is my son Vyacheslav. I brought him. Yes, it's clear. Well, show me what kind of harvest you have today. So well. Some bearded man. And here is the victim. Well, everything is clear. And happy. It's a woman. She died right with a writing pen in her hand. Probably without having time to write some more dirty tricks in her diary. What? What is this? Pen again. Holmes, how could this happen? Who did this? I don't understand it myself. Vyacheslav, why are you screaming? Did you notice something? Have you seen a beaver? Yes. Why didn't you raise the alarm? I thought it was just some cat. 1,000 devils. Ward, Papusha was here. This is simply outrageous. How stupid we are. Missed it right from under our noses. Constables, in pursuit. Well, Mr. Roy Locke, it seems you are now a complete beggar. And in addition, you will go to prison if you survive. Why didn't my grandpa kill me when I was a child? I'm crushed. Papusha, how could you? For what? Mr. Roy Locke, I am impressed by your clarity. You lived with a beaver for several months, and now you're trying to make us cry because it's over. Lovely. Well, Inspector, Watson and I were able to establish that this horrific crime was committed by the stepfather of this poor girl, Mr. Roy Locke. Actually, he committed it right before our eyes, so consider there are witnesses, and this is already a big plus, I think. Yes, we detained him. By the way, when you take it to the police station, inject some kind of anti-snake. Maybe he'll still survive. Very good. I see it's not for nothing that you bear the name of the most famous detective in the world. Holmes, by the way, does he know that you bear his name? I don't know, gentlemen. I don't know. But I know only one thing. That the crime has been solved, and Watson and I can go to London with peace of mind. We probably could have done something better. Probably some things didn't turn out the way we wanted them to. But nothing can be changed. A poor girl. She never managed to escape her fate. You can't fool fate. Fate will cheat you 100 times, and you won't be able to do the same to her. Do not beat yourself up, Watson. Yes, we couldn't save her, but we are detectives, and the main thing for us is to solve the case and let the defenders defend. And the case is solved. So beautiful woman. She did her best, even with the help of a beaver. She gave all her fortune to her fiancé. Don't you find this romantic, Holmes? Yes, she's a complete fool, of course. Look, she seems to have something sticking out of her neckline. Oh, this is a photo. Some wonderful young man. Probably this is her fiancé. Here it is written to my little Helen from her future sposo. Apparently her fiancé is some Italian. God, how sad they could never be together. I'll put it on the fireplace. Let him stand here. Here's another photo. This is probably a photo of Helen's sister's fiancé. This is her room. You are right, as always, Holmes. Here on the back is the inscription to my little sister of Helen from her future sposo. I don't understand why they are also chasing after these pasta makers. Why aren't our English men enough for them? Well, let them stand next to each other. Two young people with a broken heart and with the same fate. Holmes, my God, the photos are the same. How can this be? Al Watson, this is Professor Moriarty, the king of the underworld. Which photo? This is Papusha's stepfather, whom I met in the smuggler's secret place. Tell me which one of them. Both of them are a Watson, but if it makes it easier for you, consider that only the one on the right. This is Professor Moriarty. So it means that he was behind all the crimes of this complicated case. Yes. Now everything has fallen into place. I understood that since the beaver was here, then Moriarty was somewhere nearby. But the fact that he was ready to become a marriage swindler for the sake of his criminal plans, of course, I didn't even expect this from him. The Italians are completely insolent, but it turns out that he completely deceived us. Why? No, Watson. The main thing is that the crime is solved, and evil, at least in the person of Monsieur Roy Locke, has already been severely punished. And yet, there is still a trial ahead. Everything is like in that story about Mitchell and Cuchulainn. Yes, after all, it was not in vain that the ancient Greeks said, Die klugsten Bauern haben die schlechtesten Potato. This is very true, Watson. It cannot be true. Damn you all. Here. Look here. How do you like this? Yes, Holmes, fortune is on your side today. You should be used to this by now, Watson. I won't argue with you, Holmes. After you masterfully unraveled the Roylock case, I decided not to argue with you anymore. Yeah, our participation in this matter turned out to be quite useful, certainly. But how did you understand that it was Roylock who carried out these atrocities right after he shot Helen? Up until that moment, I still had doubts, but immediately after, my doubts were completely dispelled. Holmes, it appears that we deliberately put Helen's life in danger, but we had to make sure of everything. I understood that someone was behind Roylock and did not want to scare off the larger fish. At the same time, of course, I hoped that we would be more agile and be able to protect Helen, but as we see, my calculations turned out to be wrong. Apparently, Helen was destined to die from a bullet. I just hoped that maybe from something else. But then, as luck would have it, everything came together at one point. Some kind of isodorica. But in the end, it's not our fault that Helen chose such a neurasthenic stepfather. Absolutely right, but we must admit that we did not catch either the beaver or Moriarty. Well, that means they are destined not to be caught, that's all. But as they say, no matter how long the rope twirls, so be more optimistic. And I'll tell you what, Watson. We solved this case. We will solve others too. I'll have no doubt about this, Holmes. Gentlemen, some man came there and said he was from Devonshire. He mutters something about some mysterious crimes, somehow connected with the ancient legend of a huge luminescent beaver that has been haunting the Baskerville family for centuries. Let me in. What did I tell you, Watson? Sure shall a beaver. Exactly. And again, the heavy tread of our papusha is felt. Mrs. Hudson, tell him to come tomorrow. And today we have a day off. We need to spend a day in peace and tranquility. Speaking of peace, Vyacheslav was already ready to sing his favorite song. Great. This is what calms you down and gives you unity with nature. Come on, Vyacheslav. I'll just take a nap for now. Sorry. Literally two words. If for some reason you like this nonsense written by Watson, then allow yourself to like us, or subscribe, or maybe even send us a couple of dollars. We will use them to buy cookies for Vyacheslav, since lately he has been eating only 4 packs a day. And if you didn't like it, then excuse us, but don't judge harshly, since Watson is still a doctor. not a writer. I'm an excellent writer, Holmes, and a wonderful doctor, and a rare husband. Well, rare as a husband. Don't worry, Watson. Everything is fine. No, well, first they turn me on, and then they say that everything is fine, and then I should write about the Baskervilles. Vyacheslav, follow me. Sorry to Watson. He just fell off a camel while filming, and has not yet recovered. Thank you for your attention. We are still waiting for you.
I'm